Hello, I'm Valerie Aubin, Chair of the Cybersecurity and Critical Infrastructure Working Group of the Federal Financial Institutions Examination Council. Last year, the FFIEC hosted a webinar for community institutions, CEOs, during which we highlighted some of the cyber threat actors and key ways for senior management to help their institutions with mitigating the risks, including the importance of information sharing. In this webinar, on behalf of the FFIEC, I will highlight some of the key trends in cyber threats, what the FFIEC has been doing to help institutions address these trends, and explain the FFIEC cybersecurity assessment tool. Let's begin by looking at some of the cyber risk trends. One of the top trends that we've learned is that existing vulnerabilities continue to be exploited. Approximately 90% of successful attacks are exploiting known vulnerabilities for which there are risk mitigations such as patches that are readily available. We've also learned that new platforms are creating new cyber attack opportunities. So as financial institutions and third-party service providers adopt new technologies such as cloud computing, social networking, mobile devices and applications, cyber attackers are identifying new ways to exploit these technologies to conduct their attacks. Additionally, we've learned that the lines between cyber actors are blurring. A few years ago, it was somewhat easier to attribute attacks to individuals, organizations, and nation states. However, the cyber attack business is very lucrative and has led to greater commercialization and even specialization by these actors, which means that there are groups and individuals that specialize in every different aspect of conducting a cyber attack or a series of attacks, and they are selling each aspect online, making it harder to know who's truly sponsoring and behind these incidents. We've also learned that the tactics that cyber attackers are using evolve in response to online behavior. One of the most pervasive ways that attackers begin their attacks is by gathering information via social networking sites. You, your colleagues, your friends, third parties, family members, we all have information about ourselves online that cyber attackers can use to figure out how to best target you and other employees at the institution. By using this information, they are crafting emails to specifically look like it comes from someone you know or some group that you might be involved in, such as a charity or an alumni association. This is often the starting point for their attack. Additionally, the trends in malware are evolving. For example, we have seen increasing examples of attacks using destructive malware. This is malicious software that can destroy data, destroy the underlying systems that process and store the data, and in some instances, change the data, thereby undermining the data integrity. We've also seen, in the last couple of years, increasing instances of a use of malware called ransomware. This is malicious software that encrypts data, or in some cases, entire databases of data, making it impossible for you to access until you pay the demanded ransom and get that data decrypted. And finally, we understand that global unrest results in the changing of motivations, which leads to further attacks on financial institutions. So every story you read in the newspaper, from the most local to the most international, has a cyber attack likely associated with it. And as global unrest persists, U.S. symbols of freedom, democracy will increasingly be targeted, including financial institutions. So all of these risk trends have potential impacts, including financial, operational, legal, and reputational. And recent high-profile attacks demonstrate that cyber incidents can significantly affect capital and earnings and result in costs associated with things like forensic investigations after an attack, updating technology and business processes to address operational gaps as a result of those attacks, legal fees, consumer credit monitoring, and public relations campaigns to manage the reputation risk. Now that we've discussed some of the cyber risk trends, let's talk briefly about FFIEC's cybersecurity efforts in response to this changing risk landscape. In 2013, the FFIEC formed the Cybersecurity and Critical Infrastructure Working Group. And since its creation, we've done a number of things to raise awareness and assess risks across our institutions. This includes issuing a number of joint statements and alerts, highlighting wide-scale vulnerabilities such as Heartbleed and Shellshock, as well as specific cyber attacks targeting our institutions such as ATM cashouts, compromised credentials, distributed denial-of-service attacks, and destructive malware. We've also issued a statement on the importance of information sharing and monitoring to address these types of attacks and vulnerabilities. We also launched a cybersecurity awareness webpage on the FFIEC website. This is where we post all of our alerts and statements and publicly available information associated with our efforts. Last year, we hosted a webinar with over 5,000 attendees and also conducted a cybersecurity assessment of over 500 community institutions in 4 weeks. This assessment resulted in a general observations document found on our cybersecurity awareness webpage and the announcement in March of our FFIEC cybersecurity priorities. I'd like to highlight for you what these priorities are. The top priority has been issuing a cybersecurity assessment tool, which we will discuss further in this presentation. We also want to enhance the FFIEC's ability to conduct incident analysis. We are working on aligning and updating the FFIEC crisis management protocols and developing new training programs for our examination staff. We're updating and supplementing the IT examination handbook and enhancing our focus on technology service providers. We also are augmenting our collaboration with law enforcement and intelligence agencies. Now that we've highlighted some of the key cyber risk trends and FFIEC priorities to address these trends, I'd like to walk through the FFIEC cybersecurity assessment tool with you. The objective of the cybersecurity assessment tool is to help institutions identify their risks and determine their cybersecurity maturity. The assessment provides institutions with a repeatable and measurable process to inform management of their institution's risks and cybersecurity preparedness. This assessment tool is consistent with the principles in our FFIEC IT handbook, as well as the National Institutes of Standards and Technology cybersecurity framework and industry-accepted cybersecurity practices. The assessment consists of two parts. Part one is the inherent risk profile, and part two is cybersecurity maturity. To complete the assessment, management first assesses the institution's inherent risk profile, which is based on five categories. These categories are technology and connection types, delivery channels, online mobile products and technology services, organizational characteristics, and external threats. Within each of these five categories, there are activities, products, services that an institution may assess according to risk levels from least risk to most inherent risk. And the inherent risk profile will provide a risk description for each one of these activity, products, or services according to the type, volume, and complexity of the institution's operations and threats directed at the institution. Management completing the inherent risk profile selects the most appropriate inherent risk level for each one of these activities, services, or products within each category. Let's take a look at an excerpt from the inherent risk profile. Down the left-hand column, you will see the activities, products, or services that fall under a specific category. In this example from the inherent risk profile, we are looking at the first category of technology and connection types. Under this category, the first row is the use of Internet service provider connections. To assess the risk level associated with ISP connections, we look to the right of that first column and note that there are descriptions involving volume and complexity at each risk level, from least risk, which in this example would mean the institution has no ISP connections, all the way to most risk, which involves substantial complexity and more than 200 ISP connections. Management can determine the institution's overall inherent risk profile based on the risk associated with the most of the institution's activities, products, and services. For example, when a majority of an institution's activities, products, or services fall within the moderate risk level, management may determine that the institution has a moderate inherent risk profile. Each category, however, may pose a different level of inherent risk. Therefore, in addition to evaluating the number of instances that an institution selects for a specific risk level, management may also consider evaluating whether the specific category poses additional risk. The second part of the assessment is cybersecurity maturity. Once management understands the institution's inherent risk, both overall and in relation to specific activities, products, and services, management can assess its level of cybersecurity maturity according to five risk areas, or what the assessment calls domains. These five domains are cyber risk management and oversight, threat intelligence and collaboration, cybersecurity controls, external dependency management, and cyber incident management and response. Within each of these five domains, there are assessment factors, and under these assessment factors, there are contributing components. And under each component, there are declarative statements describing an activity that supports the assessment factor at that level of maturity. On this slide, we show each of the five domains and their assessment factors. So for domain one, cyber risk management and oversight, the assessment factors are governance, risk management, resources, and training and culture. For domain two, threat intelligence collaboration, we have the assessment factors of intelligence sourcing, monitoring and analyzing, and information sharing. In domain three, cybersecurity controls, there are three assessment factors: preventative controls, detective controls, and corrective controls. For domain four, external dependency management, the assessment factors are connections and relationships management. And for domain five, cyber incident management and resilience, the assessment factors are incident resilience planning and strategy, detection response and mitigation, and escalation and reporting. There are five levels of maturity in the assessment. They are baseline, evolving, intermediate, advanced, and innovative. Each maturity level includes a set of declarative statements that describe how the behaviors, practices, and processes of an institution can consistently produce desired outcomes. Management determines which declarative statements best fit the current practices of the institution. But it is important to note that all declarative statements in each maturity level and the previous levels must be attained and sustained to achieve that domain's maturity level. While management can determine the institution's maturity level in each domain, the assessment is not designed to identify an overall cybersecurity maturity level. The assessment starts at the baseline maturity level and progresses to the highest maturity level, the innovative level. The maturity levels are cumulative. At the baseline level, maturity is characterized by minimum expectations required by law, regulations, or recommended in supervisory guidance. This level includes compliance-driven objectives. At the evolving maturity level, maturity is characterized by additional formality of documented procedures and policies that are not already required. Risk-driven objectives are in place, and accountability for cybersecurity is formally assigned and broadened beyond protection of just customer information to incorporate information assets and systems. The intermediate maturity level is characterized by detailed formal processes. Controls are validated and consistent, and risk management practices and analytics are integrated into business strategies. Moving up to the advanced maturity level, this level is characterized by cybersecurity practices and analytics that are integrated across the lines of business. The majority of risk management processes are automated and include continuous process improvement. Accountability for risk decisions by frontline businesses is formally assigned at the advanced level of maturity. At the top of the maturity levels, the innovative level is characterized by driving innovation in people, processes, and technology for the institution and the industry to manage cyber risks. This may entail developing new controls, new tools, or creating new information sharing groups. The innovative maturity level is characterized by real-time predictive analytics that are tied to automated responses. Let's walk through an excerpt from the cybersecurity maturity part of the assessment. This excerpt shows the beginning of domain one, risk management and oversight. At the top of the page, you will see the title of the domain. And just below the domain title is the first assessment factor, which in this case is governance. Down the left side is where you can find the component, which here is oversight. The first column represents the maturity level. And in this excerpt, we are showing the baseline maturity level. And to right of that column are all of the statements associated at that level of maturity for the component under the assessment factor within this domain. As you move through the assessment, there will be declarative statements at each level of maturity for each component under each assessment factor for all five domains. It is important for institutions using the tool to consider how their inherent risk profile relates to the institution's cybersecurity maturity by interpreting and analyzing their assessment results. Management can review the institution's inherent risk profile in relation to its cybersecurity maturity results for each domain. This slide depicts a relationship between the institution's inherent risk profile and its cybersecurity maturity levels. In general, as inherent risk rises at an institution, the institution's maturity levels should also increase. An institution's inherent risk profile maturity levels will change over time, as threats, vulnerabilities, and operational environments also change. Therefore, it's important that management consider reevaluating its inherent risk profile and cybersecurity maturity periodically, and when plan changes, such as launching new products or services or implementing new connections, can affect its inherent risk profile. In addition to the cybersecurity assessment tool, the FFIEC members are providing supporting documents which are available on the FFIEC Cybersecurity Awareness webpage. These include a user's guide, which explains each part of the assessment and a step-by-step process on how to use the assessment at your institution. There is a document for CEOs and boards of directors explaining the assessment at a high level and also describing the benefits to the institution using the assessment, the roles of the CEO and board of directors, as well as questions for them to consider at their institutions when using the assessment. There is a supporting appendix that maps the statements at the baseline maturity to certain cybersecurity concepts in the FFIEC IT handbook, as well as a supporting appendix that maps the assessment to the NIST cybersecurity framework, which is an informative framework for building the assessment and for any type of organization. And there is also a glossary of terms that are used in the assessment. Now that I've walked you through the assessment, I'd like to wrap up by explaining some of the benefits of using the assessment tool at your institution. Institutions that use the tool will be able to identify factors contributing to and determining the institution's overall cyber risk. They'll be able to assess the institution's cybersecurity preparedness and evaluate whether the institution's cybersecurity preparedness is aligned with its risks. Management will also be able to determine if the risk management practices and controls are aligned or whether certain things could be enhanced and actions could be taken to achieve the institution's desired state of cybersecurity preparedness. Finally, institutions will be able to use the results of the assessment tool to inform risk management strategies. I'd like to thank you for listening to today's presentation. We hope you find this presentation as well as the assessment tool helpful with your institution's cybersecurity preparedness efforts.